His face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of His love for me, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Good evening, everyone. Before we play our prelude song tonight, we will have a moment of rock and roll history. So one of the most important rock bands in American history is called REM. They're from Athens, Georgia. They started in the 80s. And this particular year, the music world is celebrating the 40th anniversary of their first full-length album called Murmur. It's a very important album, and it contains this song we are going to start with called Talk About the Passion. And it is the perfect song for Passion Week or for Holy Week because it has a lot of images that resonate with Jesus' journey to the cross. And another interesting thing about this particular song is that you're going to hear some lyrics in French. And so I'll be singing a phrase that says, Combien du temps, which translates something like, how long will this take? Or how long must we wait? Which is a reference to the lament psalms that are read during Lent, where the psalmist cries out to God, how long, O Lord? So, beginning with a little indie rock history lesson.
Thank you. Thank you. That was powerful. Not everyone can carry the weight of the world. And we're entering into these great 3 days where we enter into the story of the one who did carry the weight of the whole world for the sake of every single person who walked on it. So welcome to worship here on this Maundy Thursday at Shepherd of the Lake Lutheran Church, wherever you are on your journey of faith, wherever you may be watching from on the live stream. Please know that we welcome you with open hearts, open minds, and an open table. So today is Maundy Thursday. As a kid, I always thought it was Monday Thursday, which was weird, but I didn't want to ask any questions. But really, the word Maundy is the same word as commandment. And so we get to hear tonight about the great commandment, the great commitment to love one another. And we get to remember Christ's last meal with his disciples. But the central focus is this commandment or this commitment we have as followers of Jesus to live out the promise that's embodied in his life, the promise of love and peace and humble service to one another. And so as we come together for worship, let's just take a moment and a nice deep breath as we enter into this story. And I would invite you to stand. We'll begin with a responsive prayer. Eternal God, in the sharing of a meal, your Son established a new covenant for all people. And in the washing of feet, he showed us the dignity of service. By the power of your Holy Spirit, strengthen our faith on this Maundy Thursday. Speak again to our hearts, feed our spirits, and refresh our bodies. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
All right, you can stay standing and join us for our gathering song tonight, Blessed Assurance. Please sing along.
Filled with his goodness.
Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have walked with Jesus thus far and will follow him to the cross. We have faced the reality of our mortality, that we are dust and to dust we shall return. And as we've shared the story of Jesus, we are assured that God never wearies of forgiving us and loving us. Let us enter into a time of reflection and confession and experience God's ever-abundant and never-failing love. Merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and makes us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. You may be seated.
At this time in the service, we will have our scripture readings. And all around the world on Maundy Thursday, there's always two stories that are read. From the New Testament, we read about Jesus' Last Supper, where Holy Communion is instituted and Jesus washes his disciples' feet and we get the commandment. And then the Old Testament story that we read every year is from Exodus, and it's the story of how God delivers God's people from captivity in Egypt. And that is in the book of Exodus chapter 12. But rather than read to you from the Bible, from Exodus 12, we're going to play that story for you now as a song. So for our first lesson tonight, let's hear a musical interpretation of Exodus chapter 12.
Strength so you can
Let's hear a fiddle. Egypt, you will see. All your slaves will finally be free. Our sweet Exodus is now at hand. We will march into the promised land.
Pass us by, angels, pass us by. House behind you as you fly through these silent streets and midnight sky. Pass us by, angels, pass us by.
Here ends the reading. Word of God, word of life. Now we hear the gospel, and so that we can get the full plot line of the story tonight, we'll hear a selection from Mark and a selection from John, so we get the story of the meal and the washing. We'll start with Mark. So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and while they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." And then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. And he said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." And now a selection from John. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. And then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I love words. For my entire adulthood, my vocation has been woven through with words. Before becoming a pastor, I was a songwriter, and I was always thinking about words, syllables, rhymes, alliteration, hyperbole. My wife, Dawn, is an editor at Augsburg Fortress, the publishing ministry of the ELCA, and she is always thinking about words, spelling, grammar, efficiency, accuracy. So you can imagine our dinner table conversations. Lutherans love words. The written word, the spoken word, the proclaimed word, the creative and redeeming word, Jesus Christ, the living word and incarnate word. Whoa, that's a lot of words. And of course, there's a lot of great stuff that comes along with words, right? Books, schools, teachers, writing, singing, preaching, absolution, publishing, translation. The list goes on and on. This is an essential part of who we are in this particular Christian tradition. So as we reflect on this holy day, Maundy Thursday, the night in which he was betrayed, I will invite you to ponder some individual words and how they function in grammar. We will explore an adjective, a verb, a noun, and my favorite, a preposition. So let's begin with an adjective. This is one of the strangest descriptive words in Christianity, Maundy. And Pastor Lila gave us a preview for our little grammar quiz here. Maundy is the word we use to describe this day. Like, you know, what kind of Thursday is this? Maundy Thursday. Now, if we're going to be sticklers about grammar, Maundy is technically an attributive noun. That means it's a noun that's attached to another noun, you know, Thursday, in order to describe it. So Maundy is behaving like an adjective. So the noun source of Maundy, like Pastor Lila said, is the English word mandate. We also get the word commandment, right? So as we heard in this gospel reading from John, Jesus says, I give you a new commandment. Were you here a few days ago on Palm Sunday? Our youth musicians led us in a song that gave us a preview for tonight's famous commandment. The song went, this is my commandment that you love one another as I have loved you. Remember that song? Yeah, that commandment is the mandate. Now, for most of our lives, very few people would ever use the word mandate. But since the coronavirus pandemic, it has returned to everyday use. Now the whole world is familiar with terms like mask mandate. And you also might be familiar with its neighboring word, mandatory. Have you noticed too, this past week has been the 4-year anniversary of the coronavirus lockdowns. Isn't that amazing? To me, it feels like a million years ago. And then on the other hand, it feels like we were just having the pandemic. So mandates were happening in society a lot in those days. And if you noticed, if you remember what was happening 4 years ago, people don't like a mandate. They say stuff like, I won't follow this mandate. It infringes upon my personal liberty. And that is correct. That's why today is such a subversive and countercultural day. Maundy Thursday, commandment Thursday, mandatory Thursday. Jesus' new commandment invites us to lay aside our individual liberty and instead become foot-washing servants of our neighbors. And here's the incredible thing about Jesus' message throughout his ministry. He is claiming that it is in the serving where true liberty is found. For example, another reading from the Gospel of Mark that is frequently read during the season of Lent is from chapter 8, verse 35. Might sound familiar. It goes like this. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. There's the adjective. Now we've reached the verb, the action word. So what is this mandate, this new commandment? Jesus says, love one another. Love is the verb. Now, these mandates we had during the pandemic lockdown, you know, they came with an obligation. Like, if you refuse to wear a mask, you're going to get kicked off the airplane. And during the lockdowns, there were entire Twitter feeds devoted to cell phone videos of people refusing to wear masks and security guards escorting them out of the cafe or out of the store. But, you know, love is a funny kind of mandate. Because the minute it's required or forced, it ain't love anymore. The instant love becomes an obligation or motivated by coercion, it stops being love. For Christians, we don't love one another because we have to. We love one another because we get to. This is a weird and world-changing mandate. There's no checklist, no hidden cameras, no interrogation. We love because Jesus loves us first, and our hearts get set on fire, and we can't help ourselves. We live in love. We get to love. All right, and now to the noun, person, place, or thing. Now, where I'm standing in our worship center, or if we were in a more traditional building, it might be called, if this was a sanctuary. This place here with the steps, this is called a chancel. And take a look, we have some wooden items here, one down there. I'd like to invite you to ponder this large horizontal wooden structure. What kind of noun do we use for that thing? Is this an altar or is it a table? Now, I would suspect that most of us regular church-going folks would call that an altar. In the churches where I was a member throughout my life, before I was a pastor, that is what people called it. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just the noun that was usually used for this kind of chancel furniture in a church building. But, you may have noticed, here at Shepherd of the Lake Lutheran Church for the past few years, we've been deliberately trying to stretch our vocabulary. And so our congregation has certain values that we proclaim every week. Wherever you are on your journey of faith, we welcome you with open hearts, open, and an open. Yeah, so what if when we see this piece of furniture, we practice calling it a table? Here's why this is important, okay? So there was an ELCA professor of liturgical studies at Pacific Lutheran University in Berkeley, California. His name is Michael Owney, and he said one of my favorite quotes. The quote goes like this: when your theology and your architecture are in conflict, architecture always wins. Let's say that together. When your theology and your architecture are in conflict, architecture always wins. Yeah. So here's how this idea plays out, okay? So, for example, if you call this an altar, your brain develops certain ideas about God. And if you call this a table, your brain develops other ideas about God. So here's the history of this object, okay? I got to get close to it. In the earliest centuries of Christianity, churches met in people's homes, and Holy Communion was celebrated around a table, just like today's gospel account of the Last Supper that we just heard. And then eventually Christianity grew to become like a more building-centric religion, especially during the Middle Ages. And that's where we get massive cathedrals like they have in Europe. Now, when they started building those massive cathedrals and church buildings, it became an architectural trend to push the altar against the wall and then keep it behind a communion rail for kneeling. And it became kind of a fenced-off holy area. And when the priest led the liturgy for communion, he did so facing the altar with his back to the congregation. Now, how many of you grew up at a church with an altar against the wall and the pastor's back facing the assembly? Yeah, right? Pretty common. I remember visiting churches when I was a kid and being told that no kids were allowed behind the railing. That altar area was only for the pastor and the altar guild. So, that's why in the old days it was really cool to be an acolyte, because then a kid could go behind the fence. Ooh. Now, this was quite common architecture for early Lutheran buildings here in America. So I think those immigrant groups, as they came to the United States, they're probably trying to hold on to what they remembered from their European roots. But get this, way back in the 1500s, Martin Luther himself knew that when your theology and your architecture are in conflict, architecture always wins. Let's say it again. When your theology and your architecture are in conflict, architecture always wins, right? So Luther and the Reformers changed church architecture. It was a reformation to more accurately support Christian theology. So Luther wrote this. He said, "Here in Wittenberg, Germany, the altar should not remain where it is. And the priest shall always face the people, as Christ doubtlessly did during the Last Supper." Whoa. And as the Reformation spread, altars got pulled away from the wall. And instead, people began to gather around the table. Now, here's an argument to use the word table rather than altar. The noun altar implies there's a sacrifice to be made. It suggests that I must do something to appease the wrath of God. In fact, I must get right with God in order to even be worthy enough to approach the altar. That's why they put railings and fences around the altar, right? Words are so powerful. They carry subliminal messages. So as we ponder the events of Maundy Thursday and the Lutheran invitation to pull out the altar and gather around it in community, let's reclaim the noun table. There's no need for a weekly re-sacrificing of Jesus' body and blood. Jesus' death on the cross was once and for all. The only sacrifice happening now is a sacrifice of thanksgiving for God's love. That's why we sing in that classic hymn, "Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our sacrifice of." Yes, the only sacrifice that happens here on Sunday morning is thankfulness and song. This body and blood we share here together, it's a gift from Christ himself. We don't have to earn it. The fence has been removed. Now, even our Roman Catholic siblings, after the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s, made this recommendation for church buildings and church furniture. They wrote, "The altar should be built separate from the wall in such a way that it is possible to walk around it easily, and that Mass can be celebrated at it facing the people, which is desirable whenever possible." Two of our leading liturgical theologians in the ELCA, Lorraine Brew and Gordon Lathrop, wrote this in 2008. "Many Lutherans, in concert with many other Christians, think the time of which Luther spoke has indeed come. The pastor should preside at the table, facing the people. The assembly needs to have a sense that it is gathered around the table, sees and hears what happens there, has a promise of Christ clearly addressed to it, participates in the thanksgiving, and is made into community through God's gift." You know, and by the way, I still call this an altar sometimes. It's hard to change our vocabulary, right? You know, Elon Musk changed the name of Twitter to X, but I still call it Twitter. So if you call this an altar because it's all you've ever known, you know, don't worry about it. That's fine. However, it's good to know the meanings of the religious words that we say. And it's good to stretch our vocabulary when we can. All right? And so that brings us to the final part of speech for this sermon, the preposition. Oh, my favorite. In Lutheran language, the prepositions are the most exciting part of grammar. Tune your ears to the liturgy, even at this very worship service, and listen for the prepositions. Especially on Maundy Thursday, we hear the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. For is the preposition to which we cling, because for means you are getting a gift. When you say to yourself, "I'm being excluded at school by my family and my friends, I don't belong," Jesus says, "Welcome to the table. This is for you." And when you say to yourself, "I'm a sinner, I feel guilty and full of shame," Jesus says, "Welcome to the table. This is for you." And when you say to yourself, "I don't understand this. My faith is weak. I don't know if I believe," Jesus says, welcome to the table. This is for you. And today, Maundy Thursday, Jesus knows when your theology and your architecture are in conflict. Architecture always wins. So Jesus pulls the altar away from the wall forever. And he sets out a banquet for us. So let's gather around the table, celebrate these wonderful gifts of God, and then refreshed and refueled, let's depart from here to live out Jesus' mandate to love one another as he has loved us. This song comes to us from England in the 1600s. It's epic. It has 7 verses. I always think of this hymn like a movie where every verse is a scene in the film. And so when we sing, you can imagine in your mind the different scenes of the movie. It's the movie of Holy Week.
My song is love unknown. My Savior is love. Love to love is shown. That day my love began. Oh, who am I? Oh, my Savior. My Lord should take frail flesh and die. My Lord should take frail flesh.
Just the high voices. Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. The peace of Christ be with you always. Please take a moment to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another. And now we come to the table. Please remain standing. And it says here in my notes, invitation to the table in Lila's own words. But my amazing colleague did that so beautifully that we'll just move right into it. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. I'd invite the communion servers forward. We serve by intinction, meaning you will first receive a wafer, and then you can dip that wafer into either the white grape juice or the purple wine and receive both together. We have a couple of stations up front here, one on the landing and then in the upper path as well. And we also have gluten-free options available at all of the stations. And again, this meal is Christ's meal, open to all, so please come.
When the rain is blowing, No, there's nothing that I wouldn't do for you. Go to the ends of the earth for you, to make you feel my love. Oh, to make you feel my love.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in this wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your life, death, and resurrection. Give us your grace as we depart, that we might serve our neighbors with open hearts, open minds, and an open table. Amen. And we do have a couple of announcements for you all. First of all, Easter's coming. Do we have a slide? Yes, Holy Week. Here we go. We're in Holy Week. So tomorrow, of course, Good Friday. We'll gather back at 7 p.m. again tomorrow evening to continue with the story. And then Easter Sunday, we have worship at 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11 a.m. We're also still looking for some folks to help us with some hospitality on Easter Sunday. So if you're going to be here, please do go onto the website and sign up to help with hospitality. And thank you so much for being with us in this Holy Week as we move through all of these beautiful stories. And now stand as you are able and receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All right, for our gathering song, or sending song, I'm actually going to have you sit down. You can sit on back down and just relax, enjoy it. We're going to talk about, were you there? in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen.